Hello, I'm Roger Landis, Senior Lecturer at Texas Tech University School of Music and Associate Director of the Vernacular Music Center. On behalf of the Lubbock Entertainment and Performing Arts Association and the Buddy Holly Educational Foundation, I want to invite you to a very special 85th birthday celebration for Lubbock's favorite son, Buddy Holly, taking place on Saturday, August 6th. In the Helen DeWitt Jones Theater at Buddy Holly Hall of Performing Arts and Sciences here in Lubbock, Texas. Join us and our distinguished guests, guitar superstars Peter Frampton, Dwayne Eddy, James Burton, Steve Cropper, and Albert Lee, with special guests Gary Talent, George Roselli, Joe Lewis Walker, Joe Brown, Mario Valens, and Gary Nicholson, along with compere Bob Harris, the legendary host of the long-running BBC show, The Old Grey Whistle Test. It's sure to be a fantastic, one-of-a-kind evening. In the interest of promoting this landmark concert, Peter Frampton very generously granted a phone interview that we are honored to present here. But first, have a look at the ticket information on your screen so you can get your tickets to this soon-to-be-sold-out show. Before and after the interview are a couple of classic videos of Peter Frampton performing two of the biggest hits from his 1976 blockbuster album, Frampton Comes Alive. The first video is about 4.5 minutes long, so the interview starts just after that. The second video will start immediately after the interview, and the concert information will be shown again at the end of the second video. Hope you enjoy it.
Show me.
I'm speaking with music legend Peter Frampton to talk about the upcoming 85th birthday gala concert for Buddy Holly. I must say it is an honor and a privilege to talk to you, and on behalf of all music lovers in Lubbock, Texas and the surrounding region, I want to thank you for being a part of this landmark concert event and for speaking with us today. So welcome, Mr. Frampton.
Well, thank you. I'm thrilled and honored to be part of it and asked to do it.
So I'm always interested in how musicians get started. And I'd like to ask you, what is your earliest musical memory?
You won't believe this, but it's true. It's true, I tell you, it's very true. I started playing guitar when I was almost eight and got my first guitar. I played a banjo-lele before that. Got my first guitar when I was eight. And my dad taught me Hang Down Your Head, Tom Dooley, Michael Rowed the Boat, and She'll Be Coming Round the Mountain When She Comes. And I got those like three chords at the most there. And so I mastered those in the afternoon and then moved on to Buddy Holly.
Wow. Well, we'll talk more about Buddy in a few minutes. Yeah, I've got some questions about
it, Buddy. It has to. The thing is that my very first performance was I needed to get a proficiency badge because everybody else at the Cub Scout place had all these badges down their arms. And I wanted to get one of the proficiency badges like everybody else. I had naked arms. So I said to my friend, what sort of things can you do? He said, well, survival is good, the survival one. So he said, that's pretty easy. You just have to light a fire. I said, oh, great. Well, I go to the scoutmaster and I say, yeah, I need to do the survival one. He gives me three matches. It's October or November in England and it's raining. So needless to say, I didn't pass my survival test. So I said, to him, well, do you have another one that would be easier? Can you suggest? He said, well, I hear that you play guitar. I said, well, yeah, I do. He said, well, why don't you bring it next Tuesday? And like you to, at the end of the session, we'll all sit down on the floor and you'll get up and play a song. So I said, okay, great. So I got up and I played Peggy Sue. So that is the beginning of my performing career was wow. with the Buddy Holly song. So
wow.
That's why I'm doing that song for the show.
Oh, great. Great. I can't wait. And so that was at the age of eight?
Yes.
Wow. Wow. Okay. So I'll have a few more questions about Buddy for you a little later.
Maybe first. Nine. Maybe you have to be nine to join the, but it was right after I started playing anyway.
Right. I have to ask, so that would have been around 1958 or 1959.
Yes.
Did you see Buddy either on the BBC or live when he, on the one tour he did of Britain? 1958?
I saw him on TV.
Wow.
But I did not see him live, no.
Okay. And so did you see him on TV before you learned the song?
No. No, oh, I wow. had I had learned the song before.
Okay.
And it was all around the same time because there was such a buzz about Buddy, you know, and he was absolutely huge in England. So and we all wanted to learn, all us guitar players wanted to learn his stuff.
Mm-hmm. So that leads into my next question. What was the first record you ever bought or were given?
Okay, well, there's two that I have to mention. My father bought our first record player, and he bought, for me, I think for Christmas, I got the Shadows at first album. And for mom, for him and mom, he bought the Hot Club de France by Django Reinhardt and Stefan.
Oh, wow.
Which I hated with a passion to start with. And of course, now I can't believe I ever didn't like it.
Yeah.
He's been Django and Hank Marvin have been with me my whole life.
Yeah.
But anyway, so, but the very first record I bought with my own money was Till I Kissed You by the Everly Brothers.
Okay.
And with Chet Atkins playing guitar on, which I didn't know at the time.
Uh-huh.
So, and I had to sneak it into the house because my father hated it. He didn't like it, you know, Till I Kissed You. I guess it couldn't have been any nicer song, you know. I don't, mm-hmm. It was just, it was part of this American and British rock and roll kind of thing that was happening. He wasn't thrilled with it.
Mm, okay. What was the first concert you attended?
It would have been a local concert, and I probably went to see, way before I joined them, The Herd.
Oh, okay.
Locally in South London, because they had a history before I joined them, and record contract and everything, but nothing really happened. And they went through various different, you know, formations, personnel changes, and then they asked me to join. So that was later on, though.
Excellent. And what was your first guitar?
My first guitar was a run-of-the-mill, they called it a plectrum guitar.
Right.
And it was just a steel string, you know. I don't think it even had a name. I think it was a no name, probably worth millions today, but I have no idea where it is. But the first electric I got was a Hofner Club 60.
Okay.
Which I bought for £25.
Okay.
12 of which I had, the rest my parents had to give me. Got the £12 from my paper round.
Yeah. Great story. Okay, at what point did you decide to make music your career?
When I was two. I think my parents knew it before I did. It's like my granddaughter is going to be a dancer. There's just no, she's two. And that's why I said that. She's two and all she wants to do is dance. I mean, she wants me to play the piano, play guitar, play music on the TV, anything. And she's off dancing. So we know what she's going to do. So, but no, I think the question was, when did I know I was going to be a musician? I guess my parents knew before I did, but probably when I was 15 or 16,
mm-hmm.
which is when The Herd asked me to join the band, then it was pretty obvious that I was going to be a musician. Yeah.
Great. So what does Buddy Holly's music or influence mean to you personally?
Well, first of all, he had a Stratocaster, Fender Stratocaster, which we didn't seem to get a lot of those. We got Hagstroms and we got Hofners, anything beginning with H. But we didn't, I remember going up to London with my grandmother. She took me up to Selma's, which was the big Charing Cross Road music store in London. And all the H guitars were out on stands, and the Fender Stratocaster was in a locked glass case. You couldn't even touch it, let alone play it. So Yeah, I think that was the first thing. He had a Stratocaster. Also, he played licks to start his songs, or he would play a solo in the middle or at the end or whatever. And I liked Elvis, but I was much more interested in Buddy because he not only sang, but he played great guitar. And he wrote all his own songs. And that was the thing that attracted me to him, that, that these were all his songs. And that's what I think influenced all of us. I mean, Beatles, Stones, everybody included, that was it for me. I mean, I loved, I would watch, I saw him on TV, but I would read all about him, and then I would I remember when I went to the secondary school, the high school, two of my buddies were Dave Jones and George Underwood, and Dave Jones, obviously, we know now as David Bowie, and so they were both in my father's art class because he was the head of the art department, and so my dad taught David and George, and of course George did Ziggy Stardust cover and lots of stuff for David, till we lost him, I think. And George is an incredible fine artist. I have one of his pieces in my house here, and so those two were the two musketeers. I was sort of a tag along musk. That was we would my dad suggested we take our guitars to school and hide them in his office and then come out and get them at lunchtime and jam, and so we did. And I remember them, George showing his favorite Buddy Holly one was Maybe Baby. Baby, baby, and oh gosh, I said, oh gosh, I didn't know that, but this is before I kind of really knew how many songs he'd done. And then so that's when George lent me that original Coral release with all the everything on it, that first album. And I have to give it back to him one day. So I'm planning on obviously going to England in November for eight shows in UK and Europe as well. And so I plan on giving him back his album finally.
Oh, wow. Wow. After all this time.
Yes.
Well, I think you've done right by the loan.
Oh yeah,
I would say.
definitely.
Yeah. So you mentioned Elvis and we were talking about Buddy. I teach the history of rock and roll class here at Texas Tech University. So I'm always interested in kind of the idea of generations or lineage. And so I was thinking about how you're roughly 7 to 10 years younger than the Beatles. And I know that you knew them and you worked with George. I'm wondering, do you consider yourself like a direct contemporary, or were you in some sense inspired by the Beatles to do what you did? What's the relationship there?
Well, I think first of all, they inspired me, but not to do what I did. I was already doing it. By the time they came out in '62, I was already in a band, the True Beats. And so I was 12 then. And no, but they obviously influenced me in many ways. I mean, I'm a technician as well as a player, and I've done a lot of my own recording and mixing and stuff over the years. And when each album would come out, I would listen to it on many levels. I would listen to it. What's the one? Revolver. When they did Revolver, and Tomorrow Never Knows was on that, that was a departure. It was backwards sounds, seagulls, mm-hmm. it sounded like, and mm-hmm. and just this almost like a drum loop, but it wasn't a loop in those days. It was playing, mm-hmm. Ringo was playing it, but it was so different from what they'd done before. I think that inspired me to always want to change it up, you know, and do different stuff. And that's why I always have. I've always done from one acoustic guitar instrumental to acoustic guitar and vocal to, you know, all the acoustic with the band, electric, light electric, and then fully blown like Humble Pie, mm-hmm. heavy metalish, you know? Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I've always been inspired to try and find something that I couldn't do yesterday or hadn't done yet up until today. You know, so today I will write something I know when I pick my guitar up a little later, and I'll write something, even if it's just a figure or it's a chord sequence or it's a quarter of a song, a tenth of a song, or an idea, you know. So I'm always trying, and I don't keep anything that sounds like what I've done before. It's gone. You know, I mm-hmm. get rid of it. And, you know, when sometimes I'll just surprise myself and out of the blue comes something new, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. you know, and those are the moments I long for, you know, they still come. They still uh-huh. come.
So you were mentioning Buddy being a model for you as a singer, a songwriter, and a guitarist. It occurs to me, and I realized preparing for this interview that I've thought this for a long time, but I just never articulated it in this way. It seems to me that you, of all people, have integrated those three roles probably as well as anyone ever has, maybe better than anyone ever has, and have had obviously an enormous amount of success doing that. Was that integration of those three roles, was that something that was conscious that you worked on, or is it just a natural expression of your musical personality?
Yeah, I think it's just, I've never really thought about that actually, but my sound and my writing, my singing, and my guitar playing just are all sort of rolled into one, really. It's not mm-hmm. like I said, okay, well, now today I'm going to be a songwriter or whatever. It's just as I progressed from an early age, I started to do more and more. And I realized that being an engineer, not that I would have called myself one at the time, but now I think I would, experimenting with sound on sound at a very early age. When I went to my father and said, I need another tape recorder, reel to reel, he said, but you've got one. I know I've got one, but I need another one. And the other thing is, Dad, you can't use the bathroom for the next 2 hours. I've made a live chamber out of it. So I did. This That's was, great. I was like 13.
That's great. Wow.
And as an aside, I got to know Les Paul pretty well, and he was a superman, a lovely guy, and told a great dirty joke. But I told him that, I said, you know what, Les, when I was going sound on sound, just like when you started, I said, I'd learned that you'd done all this stuff at home, you know, so I decided to do it. And I said, I turned the bathroom into a live chamber. He said, oh, I used to put Mary in the bathroom all the time. We got great vocal sounds there. So he said, you know, congratulations.
So you mentioned Les Paul. There's a story about Les Paul. I wonder if it's true. I wish I could ask him. That apparently he, in the 60s, he went to a club in New York to see a teenage or very young Pat Martino play. And he went backstage afterwards or during a break, and he was talking to him, and he asked him, he says, I gotta ask, can your mother recognize you on the radio? And In a way, I'd like for that to be true, and another maybe not, you know. But you would certainly never mistake Les Paul on the radio for anyone else. And it occurs to me, you have one of the most recognizable guitar styles, I think, in popular music. We wouldn't mistake you for anyone else, or anyone else for you.
Thank you. Thank you.
And also, I was aware from at least the Frampton Comes Alive record, which I was listening to in 1976 as I was growing up outside of Kansas City, Missouri. I was aware that you were combining influences. I'd been listening to a lot of prog rock, and I heard you combining different influences in your soloing, but also in your songwriting. Your chord progressions were not like anybody else.
Yeah, I hate normal. I always hated. Well, now if we're in C, now we go to F. No, we don't. We don't have to go to F or G. We can go to B flat. You know, oh, now write a melody over that. That's more interesting, you know, so.
Well, would you like to talk about some of the guitarists who influenced you?
Oh, yes. I mean, well, the first guitar player that influenced me was was Hank Marvin from the Shadows, Buddy Holly, Eddie Cochran, another one that sang and played great guitar and wrote his songs, you know. So they were sort of pretty up right up there with me, both those guys. Django Reinhardt, once I couldn't leave the room and realized, holy crap, this guy's really good. I wish he'd play electric. and then he did. but who else? Well, obviously Clapton and Peter Green and Jimi Hendrix and Gary Moore, even. I mean, wonderful player. I mean, just you name it, they've influenced me. I mean, I listen to, oh, who's that? You know, and then Shazam and find, oh, I got to get that one. And so yeah, I'm still influenced by players that I hear, you know. I listen to everything and it all goes in.
So, you've written about Frampton Comes Alive as both a quote blessing and a quote curse. I think with 17 million in sales, the blessing may seem obvious to our listeners, but what about it was a curse?
Well, it kind of stumped my career because it was so big that to follow it up a live record with a studio record was nigh on impossible to start with for me. I had the live album had 6 years worth of material on it, from Humble Pie all the way through my first four studio records. And then because I looked the way I did, I was stuck on the cover of lots of magazines and with my shirt off, and you know, people did that back then. I just anyway, and the guys started going to the back of the hall, and the girls started coming to the front of the hall, and I was being screamed at. It was like the herd deja vu, you know. I've been here, done that before, and I realized I was losing half my audience because, and then I'm in You and Sergeant Pepper. It was a ballad hit instead of a rock and roll, something a little bit more powerful, even though it was went to the top of the charts, but yeah, doesn't really matter. In the scheme of things, it was detrimental to my career. From 1980 to 87 was a very, very dry period for me. In fact, there's all sorts of things that happened, but I mean, I got ripped off by management financially. I got dropped by the label. You know, it sort of went as fast as it went up, you know, it just seemed to go down below ground, you know, and I had to, and then I think it's more, much more difficult to come back than it is to start from afresh. Because people have, when you're starting from afresh, people don't have any preconceived ideas about you. Whereas people had a lot of preconceived ideas. Mm-hmm. And a lot of it was that I turned into a teeny bopper idol, you know? Mm. So when David, Bowie, asked me to be on his record, play on his record, Never Let Me Down, and do the Glass Spider tour, that was when everything turned around. I thank David when I wake up, and I thank him before I go to bed. When he called me up and asked, would you play something for me? I said, oh yes, it's about time, you know, because we've been friends, you know, ever since he was 16, I was 13, you know. Mm-hmm. So that, I didn't realize the power of what that would do for my career, and it just turned everything around for me. And when I saw there was light at the end of the tunnel again, and people were starting, I was one of the two guitar players in David's band for those months, whatever it was, 4 months, 5 months, I don't know, of touring the world. And he reintroduced me as the guitar player, not the face. And that's, you know, without that, I don't think we'd be talking right now, to be mm-hmm. honest. I think it would have continually, who knows? But I never give up, see? I fall, I get up, I brush myself off, and it's on to the next one.
Well, we're glad you did.
Yes.
Very much. And as we're finishing up here, is there anything about Buddy that you wish listeners understood more widely? Any insight?
Just that, remember that on that variety show that he did, what was it that the Beatles did it to? What was his name? The TV show in America.
Oh, Ed Sullivan.
Ed Sullivan. Mm-hmm. That tooth was gum. Do you remember that?
The what?
I read this in the book, and right before the appearance on Ed Sullivan, one of the other two players, because it was only a trio at that point, not sure which one, they had a little dust up and they knocked Buddy's tooth out.
Oh my God. I did not know that.
I mean, maybe this is, I had a dream and this is, but I swear I read it in the book.
Wow.
And so they got some chiclets and he chewed up a bunch of gum and he stuck it in where the other tooth should be.
Wow. Wow. I'm going to have to go back and watch that clip.
Amazing. But I think Mary Elena would know better than anybody, but I don't know whether that was something they did. It was a little white lie, but I think it's true.
Wow. Wow.
Anyway, I got to go.
Thanks. One last quick question. Will you be bringing the Phoenix with you?
Yes, I will.
Oh, I'm looking forward to seeing you both. Thank you so much for speaking with us, Peter. This has been great. Thank you. We appreciate it.
No problem. Bye-bye.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Do you feel?